It started a while back, but I didn't notice. Or maybe I did, but decided not to worry about it. I've always been an anxious person. When I was a kid, my doctor told me I had an abnormally large amygdala. Or the doctor told my mom that, because I was a kid. It doesn't matter. Anyway, I've always been the type that imagines something lurking in the empty room or tells the other elementary schoolers a ghost lives in the bathroom. So, at some point, I think around 16, I decided to stop caring about anything. I was an anxiety alcoholic, and I needed to get sober. If I worried about locking my car at night, I worried about a demon living in my attic, and that my neighbors might be stealing my Wi-Fi and mail, and about the Yellowstone supervolcano. So, just like an addict, I needed to abstain. I just can't worry about my car being locked or paying a suspicious overage charge. I need to stay clean. The trade-offs are nothing compared to the week my life would be otherwise. But it's amazing the things you won't worry about when you've conditioned yourself to live this way. So keep in mind that when I say this all started when Mark Whitley moved in, it might have been a whole lot earlier. I live alone in a 3-bedroom house, the same one I grew up in. When I was 18, my parents moved from the Master into lot 45R in St. Joseph's Cemetery due to a drunk driver, specifically my father. All of my girlfriends and therapists agree that staying in the house was not a healthy decision, but rental prices are ridiculous right now and selling the thing doesn't feel right. Plus, finding a buyer wouldn't be easy. Mark was the first person I rented a room to. He was a nice enough guy, but we kept to ourselves, rarely having a conversation that wasn't about schedules or food. We had a sort of mutually understood language that kept us from needing to be too familiar. "Are you going to be home?" meant, "It would be nice if you could clear out for a few hours." And, "What happened to the bread?" meant, "Did you actually consume an entire loaf of wheat bread in the 2 days since I last went to the store?" I liked Mark Whitley, and it's a shame what happened to him. I know I'm not entirely blameless for it, but neither is he. I never hid any of the red flags. On the day he came to look at the rooms, it was raining hard, which meant the yard had become primordial sludge. The driveway stopped only about 5 feet from the porch, but I greeted him in rubber boots to make a point. He sat in his old sedan, looking at me for a little longer than would have been typical before stepping out. "Oh, Mark," he shouted over the weather. His mouth kept moving, but the words were lost. "What?" I shouted back at him. "What?" he shouted back at me. It was really coming down. I shook my head and nodded towards the covered porch that was, remember, only about 5 feet away, and we started up the steps. "It's slippery," I cautioned. "Damn!" The sole of his sneaker slid across the damp stone, and for a second, I thought he was going to fall and break his head open right there. Instead, he grabbed onto the railing and continued his ascent, vigilantly watching his step. When we made it through the door, he said, "It's raining out there." And I nodded. "No shoes," I told him. "There's a rack. I don't like vacuuming." He took off his shoes and placed them on the rack. There was silence. "So, this is it," I said, nodding my head for no reason. "Pretty simple. Living room, kitchen, bathroom over here." His head began to nod as well, and we advanced towards the hallway like two large pigeons. "You own the house?" he asked, curious. "It's an investment property," I said. He made a humming noise, as if considering the idea. I opened the door to the master bedroom. I'd had the furniture moved to storage, so it was empty. "This is the master. It'll be $700, including utilities," I told him. "It's nice, but you can hear the neighbors really well from this room." "The neighbors, what do they do?" he asked. "Parties, mostly. Lots of weird chanting and sometimes drums." "Really?" he asked. "Really," I said. "And the other neighbor plays the trombone, but it isn't loud and is actually decent." More nodding. "Is the other room quieter?" Yeah, generally, but sometimes there's a weird sound." "Weird how?" somewhere between a baby crying and a dying cat. That is weird. Yeah, I'd go with the master. "Is it cool if I have a pet rat?" he asked. And at this point, it would have been cool if he had a sled team. "Yeah, fine," I said. "Can I move on Friday?" "Yeah." "Okay, I'll do the master," he said. And on Friday, he moved in. Everything started out fine. His rat was named Herman, and he ran around in a little ball and used the tiny litter box. He did the dishes, cleaned up, watched a lot of Animal Planet. He'd bring up the neighbours every so often, just conversationally. "Did you hear them last night?" he said. "This is ridiculous." Or, "I left a stern note in their mailbox." Once he asked me if anyone had ever called the police. "I don't know. Most of the neighbours are new. I don't really know any of them," I told him. "It doesn't bother you?" he asked. "I wear noise-cancelling headphones at night. I can get you some if you want," I said. "So you really don't care about the ritual sacrifice going on next door?" "Not even a little." Things got more heated after that. There was a slow but consistent decline in Mark's quality of sleep, as could be observed by the darkening bags under his eyes. I started worrying about him. He'd sit on the couch all night watching monkeys or something and muttering about the neighbours. He stopped cleaning up and he stopped taking care of Herman. The poor little guy was so hungry he chewed out of his ball and into a cereal box. He started sleeping in a pair of running shoes I never wore, rarely ever returning to the enclosure. But Mark didn't seem to notice. After about a month of this, I had sole custody of the rat, the dishwasher, but certainly not the fridge. I said it would be better if he left, for his own sake. The neighbours were getting to him, but he begged me to let him stay. So I did. I never had a stomach for conflict, and even though I was sure he'd lost his job, he always paid the rent. "Did you hear it last night? Must have been a hell of a drum circle. It sounded like someone was being murdered." His eyes were shadowed, glued to the TV like it was a lifeline. "I told you," I said, pointing to my ears. "Noise-cancelling headphones." "It's ridiculous. Do you know what language they're speaking?" he asked. "No, I try not to think about it," I said. One of the water buffaloes on the TV had been bitten by a Komodo dragon. "You're unbelievable," he seethed. "You don't care about anyone else. Who cares about the neighbourhood? This is an investment property." "Well, traditional neighbourhood communities went out at the turn of the century, so the sounds I heard, I think they might be killing animals." He cut me off. The buffalo had escaped. "Someone would have noticed." "I noticed," he yelled. "I call the police. The police don't show up. I call the neighbourhood watch. We have a neighbourhood watch. Not a very good one. They stopped taking my calls. How does it not bother anyone else? It sounds like they're drumming on the inside of my skull. They're just hippies or..." At this point, my sobriety was on the line. "No, something bad is happening there. I feel it. I'm not going to let this go. It's... I don't know. It feels evil." "Stop acting crazy. Just make sure they don't get a hold of the Necronomicon and relax. Listen to Mr. Alvarez's trombone. Do you see what's going down with these water buffalo?" I asked. The one that had been bitten was moving slower, stumbling, trying to catch up with the herd. A group of dragons followed it. "Mr. Alvarez stopped playing months ago." He paused, watching the buffalo. "I'm going over there," he said, "and I'm taking a gun." I didn't know he had a gun. When I was about 13, I got appendicitis in my sleep. The pain was incredible, but my body stayed stuck to the bed like a refrigerator magnet, trapped somewhere between conscious and unconsciousness. One minute was awake and overwhelmed with panic. The next, a pack of dogs would be tearing out my intestines. I was conscious enough to know I needed to do something, but too unconscious to keep from being dragged back. The clearest thing I remember was this feeling, like a snake was coiled around my body, like any action I tried to take might cause the snake to bite. That's it. That's the feeling I got when he said those words. One moment, everything was normal. The next, it was cold, like that snake was looking me in the eyes, daring me to move. The room felt darker. The buffalo fell. It tried to drag itself up, but it wasn't enough. The dragons were on it, biting and tearing. Several times, it tried to stand, only to fall again to the hungry mouths. We watched as the gasping animal was transformed into meat. "That is messed up," Mark said. I wanted to say something back, but I couldn't. I sat like a statue while Mark watched the Discovery Channel. The whole time, it felt like there was a gun to my head. I told myself it was just my anxiety coming back. I wasn't afraid of Mark, even armed Mark. I'd seen the guy remove a wasp with a cup and paper. I didn't know why I was petrified. The sun set, and like my body was running through the steps of a pre-programmed script, I explained that I wasn't feeling good and that I was going to bed. He didn't even look up. I went to my room and laid down without bothering to change my clothes. I pulled on the headphones and suddenly, blackness. It didn't feel like sleep. It felt like someone had turned off my channel. I woke up to a smell I can only describe as clean. Not like the smell of oranges after you Lysol the floor. It was like the air had gone through a chemical bath. Mark was gone. Mark's things were gone. Mark's rent payments had been deleted from my bank records. The money was there, but it had been moved around, like it had come from my paycheck. Mark Whitley didn't have an email, or a LinkedIn, or a Facebook, or a website anymore. Mark Whitley had vanished. There was a skittering sound from my closet. Herman peeked out, his little nose twitching uncomfortably. His enclosure was gone. His litter box was gone. His owner was gone. All that was left of Mark Whitley was a rat. I combed through the house, looking for anything. It had been rainy lately, and the ground had been soft. But there were no longer footprints in the yard, no longer any tire tracks down the gravel driveway. Like I had spent the last week floating to and from work. That night, I slept without the headphones for the first time in years. And Mark was right. The drums felt like they were inside my skull.